So gross. Just so gross. It really kind of broke my mind for a while. And then I shared it, but kind of in a funny way. Oh, I know. I talked about the life cycle. I was like, oh, I'm going to take you on a life cycle. And then I just described this whole life cycle. And then they were just horrified.
Holy crap. Let me tell you a little something about this show. The life cycle starts when I push this button.
Okay.
Hello and welcome to the Ritual Misery Podcast, episode beta 95 for Wednesday, the 14th of September, 2016. It's still hard to say Wednesday instead of Friday. This is the show where two lifelong friends talk about geek shit and whatever else comes to mind. I'm Amos, that's Kent, and oh my god, we have invisible wife with us tonight, Bonnie Brushwood.
And she's not so invisible.
Tonight she's visible wife. That's how it is. That's just visible self. Let's go with that. Visible self.
Visible Bonnie.
Hey, I'm here.
Oh my god. So before we continue on, Bonnie is here because we've wanted to have her on for a while. But on our run up to 100, on our run up to episode 100. Mm-hmm. We decided to have a lot of people on that either influenced us or positively affected the podcast in some way, or our favorite guests from the past, and even a couple that we just never got around to having, such as
Stacy,
certain people from chat realm. So, Bonnie, we met Bonnie at South by Southwest 2015. Is that right, Kent? Did I get my year right?
Yeah. It was okay. about a year and a half ago.
We were about 30 episodes in.
Yeah.
And Bonnie gave us the first constructive criticism that we had ever received. And she said, stop saying your ums and uhs so much.
I'm really sorry. That to me needs to get addressed if it hasn't already been addressed. And some people are aware of it, and then some people just aren't. So I felt you did ask for criticism. I would never have said
it was not unsolicited.
Right.
Yeah. And it was absolutely appreciated. And the thing about it is we knew we were saying ums and uhs, but we didn't think anyone really noticed or cared because, you know, nobody said anything. So we took that criticism we became very self-conscious of it. And I don't want to say that we eliminated all of them, but I think we're much more aware now and our show is better for it. So thank you.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah, it does. You do become very self-conscious. And Brian has developed, you know, over his career, he keeps adding new semantic crutches and then he drops them. But like as he becomes aware of it and people make fun of him, then he's just like, okay. And then you just are very, very attuned to it. And then eventually you get rid of it and you get a new one. So it's okay. It's okay until, you know, it becomes obvious. And ums are the very obvious because everybody does it.
Right. The one that is kind of no, the one that is very prevalent now in almost every podcast that I listen to is the introduction with so.
Yeah.
Everyone says that now.
That really bugs me. That one's really difficult too because it gets drawn out and you're like, it's better to have silence. Just live with the silence.
Right. The uncomfortable silence.
Yeah, it is. But, you know, you're going for it with the, there I did it. when you're drawing that one word out.
I have found that so is a crutch, not only for myself, but on other podcasts. When you hear somebody say that, it's usually a matter of, okay, it's my turn to speak. I understand that. You understand that. But I am not ready to give you my formulated thought yet.
Right. Yeah. And that's pretty much what it is. I think people, it gives them that, hey, everyone pay attention to me because I'm about to speak, but let me collect my thoughts for a second. I think that's kind of what they're saying. With
so
that.
Welcome to episode beta 95, where we're going to criticize everybody else because we're suddenly fucking experts.
It's almost like the word "so" is somebody politely raising their hand in class.
Yes. Like, yes. Yes.
And they're exactly not really sticking it up there. They're just kind of like "so," and then yes.
Well, so what would the sticking up there and waving around be? Would that be like "ooh, ooh, wait"? Yes.
Mr. Carter. Is that too old of a reference? That's probably yes.
Probably not for our crowd.
Yeah, sorry.
Oh,
well,
man.
Kent, what have you been doing this week? Like, you have some different things going on. It's not just not just you chilling out.
Yeah. So if there I go with so.
It's gonna be a whole
around,
show of
I'm
it.
Not in my normal studio. I am in a hotel room. This is the first time I've done an episode from a hotel room. Unlike you, who's done it many times, this is new for me. I have my mobile setup, testing it out for the first time, and it seems to be working so far so good. No, I am in Lexington, Kentucky. Actually, a little town outside of Lexington.
What the hell are you doing there?
Yeah, I'm taking a class. My work decided that it was a good idea that I'd go get some training. I've been at this job for almost a year now, and they finally decided, hey, let's train you how to do the job.
They do understand that as a Hoosier, you're currently treading on unholy ground, right?
Oh. Right. Yeah, I don't think they fully grasp that. But when my plane landed, the first thing that entered my head was, I'm a pilgrim in an unholy land.
See, the first thing that would go through my mind is, hey, y'all!
No, that's one of the first things I heard when I got off the plane.
Did you really? Did somebody actually say that? Hey, y'all.
Oh, it's near constant. That's just how they talk around these parts.
Oh my God! Now we're gonna have all the people with southern accents killing us. Like, I'm deleting this goddamn podcast.
That's the risk we take.
I worked at a camp in the Pocono Mountains in college, and I didn't realize they were always setting me up because I said y'all all the time, and they kept trying to make me say y'all, and I was, it was embarrassing. And eventually, it turned into you guys just by being around them. It went from y'all to y'all guys to you guys, and then it came back to Texas and went the other way around. So
right.
you picked up that Yonker slink, huh? So, Kent. You're in Kentucky.
I am.
Yeah. How does it feel to be surrounded by so many Kentuckians? Kentuckians? Kentuckians?
No, you know, it's fine. I don't mind this at all. It actually reminds me of a family reunion because my mom's family is almost exclusively from Kentucky. So whenever we would have family get-togethers, this is what it sounded like. And this is what the people look like. So it's almost like being at home. So it's
one of those things that brings back certain memories. Now, my mom, her entire life has said the word "warsh." I don't know where she got it from.
Gosh.
No one in I got made fun of for saying it "warsh" when I was 5 years old. I decided then and there never to say it again. This was like the first time I corrected my own speech patterns.
Right.
So I stopped saying it, haven't said it for years. My mom used to live with us, and she continued to say it all the time. Like, it was just regular, you know, just that's how she says wash, just wash, you know, wash your hands, go wash
your clothes.
My mom
was the same way.
No one else in the house, since my mom moved away, no one said it. And then, like, 2 days ago, David, my 11-year-old son, brings out, I'm about to wash the dishes. And all of us were like, hey? Like...
The hell did you say?
It's almost like it lodges itself in the genes like a time bomb, and then it just goes off when, all right, now's the time.
Oh, yeah. Man.
Well, and here's another one, Amos.
Yeah?
They say pop here.
Instead of soda?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So another thing that's just like back home.
Pop. I never really understood. Like, to me, it was always soda, but I grew up mostly in California. You know, I was born in Indiana.
Yeah, but
went
you
to
remember
California.
Indiana, though. Everyone said pop. Nobody says soda.
Right, but I was always looked at funny because I said soda, and I could always just imagine that's how I look at you when you say pop. And they cut their pizza in squares. I never understood that either. But
hey, that's only Pizza King. Only Pizza King.
Bonnie, how have you been doing this week?
Good. good. I've been doing really good. We got Penny in school now. She started later than the other kids, so running her to her programs and everything, and it's good. It's good.
Let me see. You have three daughters.
I do. You have not been cursed. And they're all in school now. Like my little ones in a little preschool thing a couple of days. It's so cute. Oh,
my three-year-old just started school yesterday.
In fact,
does the preschool thing now because she speaks Amish. So the first two words are perfectly legible. And then as the sentence goes on, it just... And you can tell the sentence structures are there, but the syllables don't add up.
Right. That's the way I used to be, too. I'd only had, like, just until I was about four, really, I had a couple of words. But I had all the inflection, so I felt like I was communicating because you had the ups and downs and exclamations and question marks. And
yeah.
Does your daughter do that, too? Or?
Oh, yeah. If you know the subject of her sentence, you can piece the words together perfectly. But if she just walks up to you out of the blue, the context clues have to be within the first two words, because after that, it's just garbage. And trying to figure out what it is, like I said, you've got a two-word head start, and after that, you're on your own. You're playing Sudoku in the brain right there.
My oldest son, Lucas, when he was about 4 years old, he would talk like that. And we called it Lucanese. It was like his own language.
Oh, the knees part makes it sound like it's a serious disease, though. Like, oh, I'm so sorry you got Lucanese. Oh, wait. No.
he's gotten over the Lucanese, so we're good.
So I've taken on a challenge. I want to buy a new camera. My wife says we can't afford it. It's not within our budget. Okay, cool. And the other argument she had, because I can always save up for a camera, okay. The other argument she has is that I don't have time for it. So I set out on a pic-a-day challenge to take a family picture, something going on in the family, something we're doing, or someone of the family in a doing something fun and interesting every single day. And it's been 6 days, and I've gotten at least six good pictures. There's a couple days I got a couple extra pictures. I have not gotten my picture of today, though. So, you know, right as soon as we get done with this podcast, I go.
You're going to take a picture of him sleeping?
I've actually got a really good picture of David. He fell asleep while reading one night, and there was no other lights in the room except for his book light. And I got the picture, and it's just this perfect little glow against his face and the... and the page itself, and the camera that I have is just sharp enough that you can read the words of the in-focus words. It's a great picture. It actually won me a couple of contests back in Texas. And
cool.
So nothing's off limits. Like, if I've got my camera, you better not be doing something you don't want to be remembered for.
So it wasn't awkward when they read the words. I've never thought I'd be writing in this, but... I
don't even know what book he was reading, actually. But, yeah.
Oh my god.
That would be awful.
Yeah. Hopefully he's too young for that.
I need to practice my Photoshop skills so I can Photoshop a couple random pages of their journals in there, and then put it in our iPhoto feed. That'd be great. That'd be awesome. Yeah.
Mom and Dad will never know about this.
Wait, how to end up in the picture? Speaking of iPhoto, Bonnie, do you have a new phone on the way?
Yes. You were talking about pictures. That's the whole reason I want to get the new phone, is because of the... I've been taking a lot of photos, and I'm putting together a little... I don't know if it's going to be a calendar or a book, but based on the messes that my children make, because they're pretty creative. So we get some really bizarre things around the house, and they're funny, and I just like putting them out there. I call it like hashtag a fine mess.
Yeah,
is what I call it. And then like today, somehow Callie was playing with this really super cheap Barbie doll thing that I don't know, it was like a dollar store Barbie doll, and the legs popped off and broke, and she was naked, of course. So you have this little these little legs that she was just like, okay, now I got these little legs, and she stuck them in like some other toy's shoes, and then she just put them amongst all the like wrapping paper that she had been playing with. It looks really strange. So, like, you know, I want to get that new phone because it should be, you can do some new effects with it, I think. Have you guys been looking at it or?
Kent is really cheap, so he won't upgrade until absolutely necessary. And
that's not necessarily true. I upgraded to the 6S like well in advance of when I needed to.
Okay. Well, I mean, and truly, do you need to get a newer one after the 6S? I think that's...
No, I'm good till at least next year, I think.
Yeah, definitely. And Brian really liked the new upgrade, so...
It seems pretty interesting. And without doing too much of an Apple fanboy thing here...
Yeah.
Like we're known to do.
Really. Oh, really?
Yeah,
sorry.
A little bit.
That's one of our biggest criticisms. Like, just stop being Apple fanboys. Half the show is about Apple.
Can you go back to saying and just stop talking about Apple?
And then Apple's the other, is the other word that you use all the time.
Our annual gift to our families is a calendar from Apple that I put together in iPhoto. And each year I've done it. Of course, this year I'm going to have a lot more pictures because making a pic-a-day. But that's one of the things we've always done, and so that might be something for you to look into. You know, maybe take some of those a fine mess pictures and making a fine mess calendar.
That's what I'm thinking. So, when you take photos, why do you want a new camera though? Like, what kind of photos are you thinking about taking?
I take all sorts of photos, but my children are also into sports, and
that's, you need equipment for that. So.
Yeah, your normal portraits and things like that, or even panoramas, are great. I have the iPhone 6S or 6S Plus. It does great on all that stuff, but when it comes to actual sports photography,
right?
Nothing beats a good DSLR with a decent lens on it and just going down with it.
Right. You know, so. I thought I'd, you know, get a really nice lens like that. We have cameras because of Brian's work that I can borrow on occasion. But, like, I go to Penny's soccer game, and she says, I love soccer. I love soccer so much. And then she, while the game's going on, she looks, like, the opposite way from the bench. And I'm like, you're not even watching the game. Why are you not watching the game? She says, well, I'm not on the field. You know? Oh, you're not playing soccer this year, kid. That's it. I'm not going to see you, like. Not watching the game. That's awkward. Yeah, and weird.
Coach never puts us in. That's what I heard when I was assistant coach of my twins team. The coach never puts us in.
Oh,
so why should we?
Team and these are your children you didn't put in?
No. My kids were in. My kids the Sterling and Madison are like the anchors of whatever team they're in. It's always the case.
Oh, wow.
But the other girls on the bench would be looking elsewhere, and I'd be like, you should watch the game so you know what's going on, and you know you can pay attention to the other team and see what's going on with it. And they're like, well, the coach didn't put us in, so I don't see why we've got to watch the game. I'm like, that's why the coach didn't put you in, because you're not paying attention.
Exactly.
Circular logic. You're not going to win this. So.
Yeah, that's mine. She has other strengths. I wouldn't say gross motor skills to them, but... I'm going to throw her on the bus on this, but no.
All right. Well, one last bit of iPhone issues, Kent.
Yeah. So iOS 10 came out yesterday.
Yeah.
And I'm on hotel Wi-Fi, so I'm so pleased that the stream is going so well for me on Skype. But yesterday I was having a hell of a time downloading iOS 10. So at the end of the night, I was like, okay, you know, I'm done. I'm getting ready for bed. I'm going to go ahead and start the download restart for probably the third time that night. Restart the download for iOS 10. Well, I set my phone on the end table over here, set my alarm because I use my phone alarm.
I know where this is going.
Yeah. So I set my alarm, set my phone on the end table, went to bed. I woke up, not to an alarm, I woke up at like 10 minutes after 8. I have to be at class by 9. I usually get up about 7. Woke up at 10 after 8, and I was like, did I, like, screw up and not, like, set my alarm? No, I remember setting my alarm. What the heck? I picked up my phone, and I had the iOS welcome screen.
Oh.
No! Damn it! Damn it! damn it.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so I was almost late for class. And if I was late for class, I probably would have not been able to attend. And if I miss a day of class, then that pretty much negates my entire reason for being here, because I'm here for certifications and I have to be here each day to get them. And yeah, if iOS 10 had, well, if iOS 10 would have had its way and I had just not woken up on my own, is woken a word? I don't know. But yeah, that was extreme luck on my part that I just,
especially you, like, you don't like to wake up at all.
No, mornings are not my friend. I hate mornings. It doesn't matter if I got 4 hours of sleep. It doesn't matter if I got 14 hours of sleep. I am not a morning person.
We used to open his window back in high school, open his window and pick on him, like play with his nose with a stick and everything else, because his bed was right next to the window. And we'd end up messing with him and think, oh, well, he'll be up in a second, because he had a car. None of us did, right? He'll be up in a second. He'll be up in a second. You know, we'll just skip the bus, and the bus would drive right on by right in front of his house. And we'll sit there, mess with him. And he'd roll out of bed at like 3 minutes until school started and be like, okay, let's go. And because his class was like right next to the door. Ours were on the other side of the school. So we'd get there, and me and Alfie, we'd end up running to class. And he would just stroll on into his class.
Oh, man.
So, yeah.
So you left your windows open. Or were they your alarm?
Well, I had but I had like a child lock thing where my window would only open about this far, but I left it like unlocked. So they would come and open the window to the whatever it was, a half a foot or whatever it would open.
And
they would just reach in and start poking me or throwing shit into my bed. Just whatever.
And the few times he actually left his window open, like to where it opened all the way, we made him pay for it.
Oh. Did you guys ever bring the hose from around the house, or was that?
Thank God.
No, unfortunately, his mom was our mom, so we couldn't mess with the house.
Okay.
Everything had basically to be non-destructive. Yeah. So
we all shared moms.
Yeah,
so.
It was, they were all mom. So
we've had fun here too. Our kids all play at each other's houses. It's a lot of fun. This is we got some neighbors in along the street. Finally, the neighborhood finally got built out, and so all the kids go from house to house. So they know where the good snacks are at. That's
the important stuff in life.
Oh yeah, when you're eight.
So speaking of important things in life, I replaced the PS4 hard drive. I took this as an opportunity for some family time with my son, and we tried to do it together. At one point, we had like a half hour wait while it did its backup, and I told him, "Hey, why don't you go ahead and get your shower, you know, brush your teeth, get your pajamas on, and do all that stuff, and then we can finish this up." I wait like 45 minutes after the timer stops, after the backup is complete. He doesn't come back. I don't feel like going all the way up to the top story to get him. So I just continue working on it. About half an hour later, I'm done. Things are going good. I wrap everything up, head upstairs to go to bed. He's in his room reading. I'm like, dude, where'd you go? Like, I thought you fell asleep. He said, well, I thought you told me to go to bed. So obviously our communication isn't going so good. So we might need to have more family time events. But yeah, the PS4 hard drive replaced. That old hard drive is going to go into this computer and be my new Windows drive. And the current SSD that's in here now that Windows is running on is going to be my Mac drive as I try to reestablish my Hackintosh.
Hmm.
How big was the hard drive that you put in the PS4?
A 1 terabyte. It was a 1 terabyte hybrid drive. So it's actually considerably faster, but it's not a SSD, so it's not, you know, insanely expensive.
So the PlayStation doesn't have a problem with hybrid drives then?
No, nothing. I mean, it's running fine.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's running pretty good. It's just a matter of size. You can't get anything too big, which I think is what she said. But that being said, we don't have any TED Talks this week. However, Bonnie has been enlightening her life a little bit, trying to get things together.
Yeah.
Getting things done. Are you like a subscriber now?
It's done. Let me see. Let me find the author. I couldn't work off my phone and look at Audible at the same time.
Yeah, we were talking in pre-show. You can't multitask very well, right?
No, I can't. Okay, by David Allen. I think it's like an old book, and then they kind of revised it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's no, like, people talk about it as GTD, getting things done. And anyway, so it's been around for a bit, but a friend recommended it to Brian. Unfortunately, it's a case where the author reads his own book and he's really boring. He's like, it was really hard to get through. So I don't recommend the audiobook, but I recommend the book in general, because I think if you put your own voice to it and made him a little more lively, then you could probably read the book and get something out of it. But I think the best takeaway was the 2-minute rule. Like, we all have all these thoughts all the time, like, I need to do this, I need to do that. But if you do whatever you think of that will only take 2 minutes, like for me, hanging pictures was a big deal. And like, I had a bunch of pictures I wanted to move because I moved them around and the hooks weren't quite in the right spot. I'm like, that is a 2-minute job. And I just did it. And my life is so much better. And now every time I walk past it, I'm not like going, oh, my brain power is being spent on, I need to move that stupid picture. So yeah, that is a really fantastic. If it's only going to take 2 minutes, just do it. And then you can just dump it out of your brain.
So there's two things that I'm a huge fanboy of besides Diamond Club. The first is Apple.
Uh-huh.
No said. The second is CGP CGP Grey.
What is CGP Grey?
CGP Grey is a YouTuber who also does podcasts, and the YouTube videos are awesome. They get a couple million views each.
Well, I'm gonna write this down.
He's basically very OCD about his production and about how he spends his time producing his videos and spend his time working versus entertainment versus sleeping versus, you know, all these different aspects of it. And he is a huge proponent of a customized GTD. So you learn the basics of getting things done.
Oh, really? So he's talked about that on the show that you've watched.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. In fact, most of the
That's
apps
his
that
main
I use.
Focus.
Yeah. Most of the apps that I use to prioritize my life are based on the GTD setup. And again, it's customized. You take the 80% that applies to you, toss out the 20%,
right,
and work within the structure of your life. And I've been much more productive.
Yes. And you kind of would think that, like, I think as an artist, I really resisted taking on a formula or something that
structured approach.
Yeah, some kind of like systematic approach. But I just found I didn't have time to really make the things that make me happen. So by stepping out of my comfort zone and being much more dedicated to lists and time management, I'm able to get so much more of what I really want to do done, which is neat. Like, I'm making art. Yay.
Speaking of doing things that make you, we skipped over a little bit, but you like to play some Space Pirates on the Vive. You got some little virtual reality action going on. How's that doing for you? Are you not one of those people that gets sick on the 3D movies and the virtual reality?
I don't get sick on it. It's not. I think the one that Brian has at the Vive is the first one that kind of grounds you in it. I know some people do. And we did have one of the neighbors come over. She was 8, and she peed her pants. Oh, she got so it's totally intense. I mean, you get in and you feel submerged in this world. So, it's an experience. I think it's worth exploring if you ever get a chance. Like, take the time to jump in. Have you guys done it?
Mm-mm.
No,
I have not done VR at all yet, and I cannot wait.
I
think it's the future of gaming. That's without having done it yet.
The Verizon here has the Samsung Gear VR or whatever that you can try out in the store, which of course is guaranteed to give you pink eye if you're not careful. But I tried that, and I had my wife try it, and it was pretty amazing for the 3-minute demo or whatever that you got out of it. It was pretty cool. But I haven't actually tried the full setup.
I think it's pretty fun. I hadn't tried that one. I you know, I don't know enough about all the different stuff. But this was, Brian had tried this one at a friend's house and was sold on it. And they keep releasing new cool stuff. And I like the drawing program is really cool to get in there and you feel like you're manipulating stuff, which is cool.
I've seen some of the streams that he and Bryce have done with the Don't Stop Talking and things like that. And it's hilarious. And I can't wait to try things like that with the family on family, you know, game night and movie nights, stuff like that. So it's really exciting. I'm excited about it and I've never really done it. So that kind of tells you where the vibe is at. Right.
Right. And you know, I'm not a gamer. Like Brian's a gamer. The kids like playing games, but I think I'm just old enough. I didn't hit that wave. I mean, I did do the 8-bit games as a kid, but then once I just got past, you know, got too busy for it, I just never really followed things. Plus, to be good at a lot of these games, you have to like put a lot of time into it. So that's
my problem. I used to game a lot when I was younger, like especially when I was single.
Yes!
High school in particular, I gamed a lot. And then just over the years, about the best that I do these days is Angry Birds.
Oh, I'll do. That's true. Well, you know, I would say like those little games on the iOS, but I don't even do those. But I did at one point. So you like Angry Birds still, or is there a different one?
No, I still play Angry Birds. It's one of those things that I've got 2 minutes or, you know, whatever. I'm waiting on something to happen so I can just pull out my phone, play it for a couple of minutes, put it away, and it's whatever.
Right.
It's gone.
I'm not quite that.
I don't have to. What's that, Amos?
I'm not quite that retro. I'm still stuck on Fallout 4. What is that? Fallout Shelter.
Oh.
Yeah. I just recently got back into that. Like I was looking down my little list of installed applications, looking for a specific one, and I saw that, and I was like, oh.
Charming.
And on my new iPad Pro, Zombie Gunship is so fun. Like it just flying around a C-130 attack bird and killing zombies by the hundreds. Come on. that's just good times right there. So now, Bonnie, you say you are not a gamer.
Right.
But we know you are a mom.
Yes.
You're an artist.
Yes.
You are the wife of a performance artist.
Right.
What would you say is the biggest aspect of that that really just captures the essence of Bonnie? What part of it do you feel is most you?
Let's see.
I like asking the tough questions, aka the
that
confusing
is a,
ones.
Yeah, that is tricky. I like it. I think setting up the kids to do their own projects is very me. I like setting up for Josie. She's real into inventing right now. Like, y'all know Jaime, and he has his inventions that we've seen. Tensor guy in the chat. So, we've gotten to see some of his products being developed, and that was a real inspiration to Josie. So she has a whole maker station outside that I whenever I find a box that I'm like, oh yeah, Josie would like this box. I like this box. If I had time to invent, I would invent with this box. So we have this whole collection of just stuff. So she's making some really wacky things. And then Penny, she paints sometimes, but is more into reading. So she's kind of gotten out of arting. But I do set her up with books, I guess, kind of librarian. And then Callie is just, you know, she's three, and all three-year-olds are just destructos. any hard time finding anything to play with. So, but I'm pretty chill about it because I understand being attracted to the sensory experiences that a three-year-old goes through. So I don't mind like dealing with the mess, but I do try to make her be the one cleaning it up. So that's a task. Yeah.
My youngest son, Isaac, he was so destructive. We called him Hurricane Isaac.
Oh, cause that is a hurricane name. I've heard of Hurricane Isaac.
Exactly.
So the first time I met Isaac, I believe, because I didn't meet him in Japan, right?
No, he wasn't born in Vegas, right? We got to Vegas.
Okay, so my wife and I went to visit Kent's wife in Vegas while he was actually deployed again. Was I in Korea?
No, I was deployed. Yeah, that's right.
So we went, and it was on our honeymoon, and we went up there, and it was the first time I'd met Isaac. I'd met Lucas before, hung out with Lucas a little bit, and of course, Kent's ex-wife Chris was, you know, a high school friend of ours as well. So, you know, it's kind of, you know, just family, right? Mm-hmm. And I was amazed because we didn't get there until like 11 o'clock at night, and Luke was. He was done. He was like, "Hi, Uncle Amos, I'm out," and he just went to bed.
Right.
Isaac, on the other hand, was just hitting his stride. So we were there for like 2 hours. We were there for about three beers worth, and Isaac was just hitting his stride when we got there, and it was nuts the entire time. We had half a conversation 15 times. So.
Wow.
That's amazing. And he probably was about 3 years old at that time too.
Yeah,
so.
About that. Yeah. So back in what 08 ish,
probably 06. I'm thinking.
Mm. See, time flies. Time's crazy.
Yeah. It's yeah. So, yeah.
Now with your kids, what do you find is the easiest way to inspire them? Like, because this is one of my things. I'm always looking at other parents. Especially the parents that I see online that talk about their kids openly and honestly, you, Scott Johnson, a few others. And the thing that always gets me is that you always seem to be inspiring your kids to do more. And I can't inspire my kids to do anything but consume. I've been trying like mad to get them to create and you know, bring their concepts to life. Like all they want to do is watch TV, read crazy girly books that don't even belong in the bookshelf. Like, how many times can you rewrite the same story? You know, but
I understand what you're talking about. We had like adopt puppy stories that there was like 20 of them, and it's just like, it's just like, yeah, the dog gets adopted, yay!
Oh my god, Autumn still talks about Sam. Like, she brought him up today about he was in the room with her and they were playing. Sam is our German Shepherd that died right after. Right before South by Southwest this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And but she's still talking. We still find his hair everywhere, so that doesn't help.
Oh, jeez.
but yeah, she always talks about him. She loves that dog, and it's sad. But anyway, enough of the sombre moment. I'm going to have another sip of beer and give it over to Bonnie so our guest can actually speak her mind.
Well, we wound up having some challenges with our oldest. You know, the first are always
the trial beds.
Yeah, they're the experiment.
They're the beta.
The betas. Yeah, so she is has some special learning needs, and that we're dealing with that and just trying to accommodate those things. And then, but in doing so, we found something called the nurtured heart approach. It's in the books, like as you're reading, it's called NHA. I think Howard. I know the first guy's name is Howard, the guy that wrote it, but I can't remember the last name. But anyways, highly suggest these books. It's a very positive discipline approach. And well, I have three girls, and then two of them are very respond really well on this. But the middle one still needs kind of your regular discipline. Like the discipline that works for 95% of the kids is what we do with the middle kid, because she likes it. It's good. And then, but the other two, we use this nurtured heart program where you need to anchor.
Howard Glasser.
Thank you. Oh, you found it. Yeah. Okay. Nurtured heart approach. Yeah. NHA. And you anchor the behaviors that you're looking for when you see them. So if maybe your kid's really shy, mine aren't shy, but say your kid's really shy and you want them to make new friends. Well, when they're out and they like are hanging out with somebody on the playground, like while they're doing that, you just walk up. You think usually you would never interrupt like good behavior. And that's a problem. You know, we should give them attention for good behavior. So when they're being friendly, you're like, I see you're being friendly. You're making a friend. And then like, just notice them. That's it. You know, like you don't have to be fake about it. I mean, you're noticing the actual behavior and you're anchoring it. and they're getting attention for it. So that you want less attention for bad things. Like, oh, why don't you go out and play? You know, if you spend 20 minutes on that, they're getting attention for, you know, they're getting that attention. And then that kind of feeds into itself. So they seek that out and do those behaviors. But if they're exhibiting good behaviors, then you want to anchor it and give them attention for it. So that's kind of that approach. It's a lot more, there's a lot more to it. And there's studies that show, you know, how effective it is. And just in our personal life, it's been fantastic. So and it's easy to get kids to want to do things. And it's not like we're super ambitious, Mountain Dew type parents that are always like, do more, rock it, you know.
Just do it.
Yeah, no, it's kind of like, oh, I see you wrote a song. Wow. Like, you sat down and did the hard work of writing the lyrics out, you know, and then they like that, so they make another song.
I'm always trying to find ways to introduce creativity and to instill it and try to get it going. Like, Kent didn't have any problem. He's got, well, my oldest daughters, Amber and Ashley, will draw to their heart's content all day long. They're actually really good at it. They don't like sharing it with anybody. Like, you have to coax it out of them.
Right.
Kent's oldest son, Lucas, he's been in film. He's designing Hearthstone cards. He's making, like,
he makes board games, yeah. Card games.
He's a creation powerhouse. He just constantly churns.
I love it.
Is Isaac the same way, or is that?
Much lesser extent. Yeah. He's
got other focus areas.
Yeah. The thing with Isaac, he moves from thing to thing. So he'll be all about a certain thing for a week.
Right.
And then next week it's something else. And the next week it's something else. And next week.
So he's totally his mom. That's all that is.
Do you know?
To a point. I'm a little bit like that myself, though, where if I get into something, I'm into it until I'm not. You know, I don't know. This whole podcast thing is one of the things that I've stuck to the longest.
Well, yeah.
I mean, usually my interests, they tend to still exist, but I don't nurture them after a certain amount of time.
Right.
The podcast thing is something that I've stuck to, and I'm getting more into it, I think, as time goes on.
Now, go ahead, Bonnie.
Yeah, go ahead, Bonnie.
Yeah, I'm working on this Skype thing here. Figure it out. I read a book called Grit. I don't know if you guys, it's kind of been on the top of the charts on nonfiction. And in Grit, they talk about nuance, about how to make things new and stick with it. But also within that, there's a lot of activities that we do that we do until we get what we need out of it. So, like, my daughter used to be, I guess I said my kids aren't shy, but Josie used to be really shy until she took Kung Fu. And then she got halfway through and we're so excited that it's like really kick ass Kung Fu kid. And then she just quit. We're like, she did it. Like, she was not scared of certain situations anymore. She had like this power that she was proud of. She's like, I'm fine. I don't need it anymore. I want to do other things because there's other things that I need to do to get skills. And I think we do that even as adults. She's like, I'm going to do this until I get what I need. And it's okay to ditch it. Like, you don't have time for everything. So if you get whatever that is that you're like, oh, I think I like this for this reason. And yeah, ditch it and go for something else. But if it's something you want to keep doing, then really work on nuance to keep your interest in it.
Right, right.
It's awesome. Yeah.
So we've been talking a lot about our kids, and something that I think all of our kids have had in common is allergies.
Oh, really? I didn't
particularly,
know that.
Particularly food allergies.
Yeah. So I knew you had food allergies, but did Amos, do you also? Or
I don't. But my oldest daughter Amber, she did when she was little. She had a milk allergy, and it caused her to be colicky for about the first 8 months of her life.
Right.
And Madison, the older twin, has an allergy to red dye, where it's essentially, imagine getting like poison ivy. Like, it's just this big red rash that is just super itchy, and we got to give her 2 tons of Sudafed to get rid of it. It's not harmful, but it's completely uncomfortable. And
it is, and then it takes a week to heal from that,
and you, she can't sleep the whole time, and yeah, it's ridiculous, and just from drinking some Kool-Aid, you know.
Well, it's weird. Like, it's also like in red meat. They sometimes put it in red meat and some other. I mean, you know this because you've got the.
Yeah.
You know, you live with it, but it finds its way in strange places. Like the food doesn't have to be red to have red dye in it. You know.
Yeah. A lot of times you'll find it in blue, actually, because apparently blue is really heavy in red. I don't understand. I'm not a colorologist or anything, but.
Yeah.
But your kids have some pretty severe allergies, you know, to the point where airplane rides and things like that add difficulty.
Is this Kent or us?
For you.
Oh, you, Bonnie.
Yes, that is, you know, and then all the parents give you the stink eye because you like walk on the plane before everybody else. And you're like, look, and then they come on. And then I think they feel the shame of having given me stink eye because I'm wiping down the whole, you know, our whole area. I'm like, yeah, I get to clean the plane. That's really sexy walking on early. So I can clean the plane. But we do get our pick of seats. So that's awesome because we always fly Southwest. So we get to sit wherever.
Nice.
That is a concern. And for the first time, I'm going to send Penny, who she has the worst of the allergies, but I'm sending her on a camp by herself with the school. And there's other students. For some reason, the school she goes to, like a lot of the kids have food allergies, about half of them do. And they've gone before and they're really sensitive to that and take good care of the kids. So I feel okay. It's just that egg allergy is it's just hard to work around.
Being allergic to eggs?
Yeah. It shows in a lot of the convenience foods have egg in there somehow. So it's hard to cook, and especially cook. You get a lot of protein in it. So schools or camps and stuff put eggs at every meal, especially in the mornings and stuff. And like, how do you do, by law, they have to do a nutritionally balanced meal to serve children and get whatever kind of governmental okay to run their operation. But in doing so, they're threatening my kid who really shouldn't be around eggs. Yeah.
Right. How old's your oldest kid?
She's 12, and this is a hard year for us because we just went and did all the testing, and they said she's going to live with this her whole life. It's like if she hasn't gotten rid of it by 12, then she's going to be, you know, she's living with this.
Oh, wow.
My youngest son is 12, and when he was born, he had severe allergies.
Speaking of red dye allergy. Wasn't Isaac allergic to red dyes? Like eating strawberries would break him out?
Not so much red dye, but he was allergic to everything else, I think.
Okay. Yes.
Dairy especially. He had such a severe allergy for dairy that he was like constantly threatened to go into what is it called? Anaphylactic shock.
Yeah.
His dairy allergy was so bad. Well, he was breastfed, so we didn't like have any clue about it when he was really little. When he was how old are they? 4, 5, 6 months when they start like holding on to furniture and like kind of scooting around or whatever.
Yes, yeah.
Well, my oldest son had left a glass of milk on the table, and so my youngest son was holding on to furniture and scooting around or whatever, and he accidentally knocks over the glass of milk on himself. And you would think that someone threw acid on his face.
Yeah.
Because he just, like, his skin just instantly started bubbling up, and it was just really red and angry looking. And, you know, of course, we took him to the emergency room, and the doctors, like, they were, like, this close to doing an investigation on us because they thought that we were abusing the child. You know, what did you put on him? Milk is the only thing that's contact. No, milk does not do that. Milk does not do.
Well, I had some chlorine lying around and some vinegar, right. And I figured those two would make a really good hair dressing.
Exactly. No, but you know, and that, he had to deal with that, not just with dairy, but with legumes and all sorts of I can't even think of all of them right now.
I can't believe we didn't talk about this. I had no idea that you had that shared experience. I mean, the same age, and yeah.
Right. But now he's almost over, almost completely over all of it now.
Oh, that's awesome.
He's able to eat dairy now. Like, dairy on occasion will give him like some irritation.
Right.
But he can absolutely eat it. Mac and cheese is one of his favorite things to eat now.
Oh, wow. That's
so
fantastic.
Yeah, and it's amazing. And I was just curious about the status of your daughter. Like, and you already answered that she's, yeah, you know, she's just gonna have to deal with it. That's unfortunate.
Yeah, I mean, did y'all do anything special, like any kind of treatments or anything, or you just
No avoidance, and then the doctors suggested that, like, you know, maybe once a year or something like that, just kind of try to introduce something, not in any kind of quantity, but just a little bit, just like maybe, like, especially with dairy, like a little bit of skin contact or something like that, just to see what happens, you know. Mm-hmm. Because like in very small amounts, it wasn't super dangerous. You know, we always had Benadryl around. We never had to do the EpiPen. Had to do the EpiPen.
Did y'all carry an EpiPen, or you just got to take a Benadryl?
No, we carried Benadryl around everywhere.
Yeah.
But we were very careful, though, to avoid certain things. Oh, seafood was another one. If we walked into a seafood restaurant, he would start projectile vomiting immediately.
Oh, gosh, that's amazing to have outgrown all that. I mean, for somebody who's sensitive, you would. Yeah, because Penny is just as sensitive with different things. And hers, she's just.
Now, Bonnie, do you have any allergies? You or Brian have any allergies?
I'm lame. I have an allergy to latex and to penicillin. And then also, what is it? I developed an allergy to acrylic, I think, just from working with it all the time and with the art. So I've switched to oils now, and that's been very helpful. I didn't realize it until like a couple of years ago. I was like, oh. And then acrylic is in a lot of lotions and stuff. So all this beauty care, I looked at the back of all the canisters, and then like I had to throw away all this makeup that had acrylic in it, and now my skin's happy. So yay.
but no food allergies. And that's same with,
but my with mom did. My mom did. And then I think Brian did. He was real colicky. I think they just didn't know. Because even with Penny, they weren't saying food allergies until she actually started to get hives from it. But my mom had egg allergies too, which I think is kind of weird. It even like that allergy tends to follow along. So she was egg, and her aunt, or my aunt, was telling me recently how they would have the doctor out after hours, like if she had an exposure. She had asthma really bad, and they were like, yeah, we thought you were gonna die, and Dr. Lawler stood over you and made sure you were breathing. And that's just, and my mom's like, really? I don't remember any of that. I'm like, no, you're a kid. But hers were, it must have been anaphylactic. She doesn't really have the full story, and she was little, but she outgrew hers. However, as a 6-year-old, I'm going to tell my mom's age, but she's in like late 60s, and she moved back up to Austin and started having environmental allergies to the point where she had asthma again, and her food allergy came back. So I feel like the environmental allergies weaken you and kind of make that food allergy thing. Now, you're in the military, and you guys moved around a lot, I bet. Did your kids move around, or?
Yeah. Everywhere that I went, other than deployments, of course, and not to Korea, but everywhere else in the world that I've been, they were there with me.
Right. So I wonder if that didn't help by not being in one area and being attacked by trees all the time.
Well, yeah, because your daughter's basically lived in the same area, like most.
Yeah,
of life,
we've been
right?
in the same area, like same you know, metropolitan environment area. For our whole life. So,
Well, I know with seasonal allergies, regional allergies, things like, you know, the pollens and things like that.
Yes.
A lot of people can avoid that, or at least there's been promising studies that show that by doing things like eating local honey. things like that can alleviate those things.
I can fix your
possibly even cure.
I can fix hay fever. Mm-hmm. Solve it. Move to Hawaii. I had zero allergies the entire time I was in Hawaii, unaided by medications or anything else. It was the most amazing 4 years of my sinus career since I was 12 years old when I first developed my hay fever. Mm. Of course, I developed my hay fever and my allergy to cats at the same time. And as Kent can tell you, they're both completely debilitating to me. I cannot function when I'm having a full blown attack. And that was one of the things that used to kill me is Kent always had cats.
Oh, that makes it hard to visit.
So every time I'd go to his house, it'd be like I'd sit there and I'd just stand up at some point and be like, okay, time to go. Like whatever medication I had taken to go over there had worn off. Eyes were itchy. If I touched my face, I'm going to die. So it's time to walk out of the room.
That's what I was going to say. Like Brian like sits down and he's like a robot at cat houses. And he's just like, don't touch your eyes. Don't. And then if you wear contacts, it's even worse because then you touch your eyes and you're like, ah. So.
Yeah, I didn't have allergies at all until I turned 12. And now I'm allergic to cats. I've got hay fever and codeine is the worst experience I can possibly have.
Oh, yikes.
Yeah, especially with all the surgeries I have, they're always trying to give me codeine. I'm just like,
thank you.
I can't.
So, Bonnie, is there any like promising treatments for allergies, like either in short term or like long term getting over it? You know, like I was talking about the, you know, eat local honey to avoid seasonal allergies or whatever. Is there anything like that for food allergies that you know of?
There is. In fact, my littlest, all three girls have food allergies. So the littlest is getting all her testing and she's 3, going to be 4. She might be able to be in a study that does the, like they give you the tiny bits of peanut and then you keep increasing it. So it's the same thing as allergy shots, but it's called immunoslip treatments. And you just keep building your tolerance to it. You have to do it through a doctor. It's part of a study right now. So they're not doing it just everywhere. You have to be signed up for a study. And then eventually when it's deemed safe enough, then it'll be on the market. But Penny's too old for it. It's not effective for anybody as old as she is. It is effective for 4-year-olds. So they're hopeful that maybe Josie or Callie can get on that. Josie seems to be, you know, she's never been as allergic. So we're hoping that she outgrows it, but she might even be too old at 8 to do it. So the sooner you get to it, the better. But outside of that, also, I feel like the conjunction of just treating seasonal allergies does help alleviate your other allergies also. So just taming one helps tame the others. So I recommend doing the shots if you can do that, but that it's time consuming and expensive. So, you know, you got to weigh all those costs. We haven't started shots because Penny's kind of afraid of it. And also taking her out of school for a shot so she can like cry and freak out about it. I don't know. We hadn't done that yet, but I would like her.
I was really timid about shots until I got my smallpox.
Oh really?
And then when they're standing there stabbing you in the arm like 20 times with this two-pronged needle,
it's awful.
It's the most horrible experience ever as far as like shots go. It doesn't even hurt, but in your mind it's like I'm dying right now. Like I'm being killed. They're injecting me with this highly infectious disease. They're trying to kill me. I'm going to be permanently scarred by this crap. Oh, yeah.
Doesn't it? It leaves like a little round scar or something. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And what kills me about this, the military tattoo was probably about what, 10 years ago, Amos, that we started doing the smallpox thing.
About that. Yeah.
Everybody was up in arms about the anthrax shot. There were people refusing the order to take the shot and being thrown out of the military. There was all kinds of crap about the anthrax shot, but nobody has ever died from an anthrax shot ever.
Right.
Smallpox, on the other hand, there's many, many, many documented cases of deaths from the smallpox vaccine.
Really?
And one, at least not that I heard of, not a single service member refused to take that or even raised hell about it.
Now, anecdotally, I will tell you that right after maybe like my third booster of taking the anthrax, I developed hemangiomas all over my body, like little tiny ones.
Really?
No, could be completely genetic. Might be the anthrax. Might be that I, you know, walked by a plant that I don't know that I'm allergic to. Who knows? So I've got all these hemangiomas all over my body. Little tiny ones. Most of them look like freckles. They're just like, they look like red freckles. Not long after that same time period, my ex-wife and I conceived Amber, my oldest, and she was born with 19 very large hemangiomas all over her body, and still has some of them, like they've permanently scarred a spot on her leg and things like that. And she had one on her lip that was like on her lip, caused her lip to swell, end up leading into a staph infection when you follow the chain all the way out. So had a major effect. Now, is that the cause of anthrax? Who knows? But it was during that exact same time with nothing else really changed in life. Completely anecdotally, just saying it, just putting it out there for the record so the VA can hear it and sue me one day.
Right. No, that's an interesting thing too, because you worked on the flight line at the time as well. And in that environment, we're exposed to all sorts of chemicals.
Let's not get into the heavy metal poisoning that causes me to twitch and that nobody wants to acknowledge, you know?
Right. You know, radiation from the radars, there's so much in the environment on the flight line.
Yeah.
That who knows, dude?
Exactly.
Who knows?
You know, I was talking to this guy who he heads up Texas State Technical College. It's like some part of that. But anyways, a lot of their campuses are associated with retired bases. Like they put the schools on those retired bases. And as they're cleaning up, they still have all this like debris from like air, you know, just like stuff that goes with Army, I guess. I don't know. I don't know if it's Army or what brand, but he said, yeah, we had to bring in specialists because there were, you know, like the knobs were painted with like radioactive stuff so that they'd be glow in the dark. And
oh, wow.
Yeah. And there was like a lot of like super toxic stuff. And these are just kids going to school to learn how to be like air conditioned specialists and have no idea about like, oh, there's equipment and stuff. But meanwhile, there's just like, oh, right. Yeah, we need, it's good. Like you take a Geiger counter and it's like, beep, 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 beep.
It's like,
that's crazy.
You went to your school and got mesothelioma. Who cares? I went to my school and now my left eye glows.
Right. I grew a third arm.
I mean, part of me is like, oh, that's really cool. You
know? I was able to join the X-Men.
right. After that, it is a special school, like the X-Men. That's how they got there.
So we do have a couple of announcements to make.
Cool.
First of all, if you like this show and you want to help support us, go over to geekandgamergear.com. Cruise by there, get 10% off by using the coupon code Ritual Misery, and find some great retro stuff, especially with the new Nintendo little USB thing coming out. That's going to be amazing. I'm sure they're going to have tons of stuff on there for that.
Absolutely.
And Kent, while you're in Kentucky, you're going to have a little bit of a Diamond Club hangout for the this weekend, little get-together.
Yeah, Emily and I, Hot Beverages.
In the chat room,
yeah. Yeah, Hot Beverages from chat. Have decided that since Cincinnati is only about an hour and a half from here, which is near where she's located, we're going to try to do a mini Diamond Club meetup this Saturday. So anyone that's in the Cincinnati area or can easily get to the Cincinnati area on Saturday, hit up either me or Hot Beverages on Twitter, and we will give you all the info for where we're going to meet up. There is an Oktoberfest happening in Cincinnati this weekend, so that's probably going to be where we're going to be located.
And I'm not saying that we're going to do something with the broadcast, but Kent does have Skype on his phone. So
right. So something may or may not occur this weekend.
I'm just going to put that right here. I'm just going to leave that right there, let that happen.
To be looking at something.
Absolutely.
So M and I are still setting up the details, but it's almost for sure going to happen.
That's
so
awesome.
Like Darth Steve, I think is probably going to be there. There's a, I don't know, a few other people that we've been in contact with that It's going to be a good time. So if you can make it, please, by all means, make it.
I just love hot beverages, man. She came out to, she came, you know, she made a special trip to several of the meetups. And one of the things I thought was really cool is that she made awards for the podcast. I don't know if you followed all the podcast awards drama.
Right.
She came through and made awards for everybody. I was like, how cool are you? That is so neat. So
yeah, she's awesome.
Yeah, yeah, I thought that was neat.
So we had the Ritual Misery meetup before the Diamond Club meetup at South By, and we met a lot of people there, and it was one of those things, like, it was so many people that there was no way that I could really gather everybody in and commit them to memory. I mean, so many people were there, and they would tell me what their chat handle was, and I'd be like, cool. Oh shit, I've had a beer and I forgot. Like, you know, it was just one of those things. And you know, especially once the crew showed up, you know, Brian, Justin, and Tom and everybody, and they got there and showed up, it just became this drunken haze.
And Bonnie.
Yeah. She ended up just sitting there and talking, and like, she was real quiet, and like, there'd be a picture opportunity and she'd pop up and then she'd turn around and be talking again. And I think she talked to my wife more than anybody else there, and they just had this little private conversation for like, I don't know, 6 or 8 hours or something.
Yeah.
But every time a camera showed up, like, they would just turn around and be part of the picture and then go back to doing whatever they're doing. So that night, I really, like, I remember meeting a lot of people and stuff like that. But the next day, when we were setting up for Night Attack Live, Austin Night Attack Live, we had our shirts on. We were there. We were setting up cameras, setting up computers, and going. And I had this one spot that had been like, oh, man, this would be perfect for a camera. But there's someone sitting there. It was Emily. And she was like, oh, you need this spot? And in my mind, I translated it to, oh, you need the spot that I've been sitting here for 3 hours to make sure that I had my perfect spot? The only spot that I'm really going to be comfortable in this entire bar? Like, the one spot that fulfills all of my needs as far as my comfortable level in a public place and with new people and stuff? The one spot, and you need it? Okay.
Did you take it?
Well, she moved out of the way temporarily while I set up the cameras, and then made sure that everything was set up so she could have the spot back.
Oh, what a gentleman!
But it was just like you could see the look in her face, like, this is my spot.
Yeah. Right, but she was willing to give it up for, you know, the greater good or whatever.
And she was just awesome. And from that point on, I knew. I mean, I was like, okay, this is the person I'm going to remember the face of, and I'm never going to forget this again. So she's really cool.
No, Emily is amazing. That girl is just crazy.
So that being said, if you want to go do that in Kentucky, well, I guess it's not Kentucky. It's
Ohio, but it's right on the Kentucky board. It's actually in the tri-state little thing, the Indiana, Kentucky, Ohio. It's like right there in that little corner, but it's technically Ohio.
Sure. It's where the Bengals play, I think, like somewhere around there. That's cool.
You had me in a panic though. You're talking Oktoberfest, and I was like, wait, what's the date? Like, so are they doing, when is this going on?
This weekend, this coming Saturday. Yeah.
So they're just jumping the gun and doing it in September.
It's no. Oktoberfest happens in September.
Oh, well, wait. How did I forget this? Why?
Yeah, the real Oktoberfest in Germany is in, it begins in September and it ends in October.
Oh, okay. So this is the long process of celebrating. Is it just the beer? I don't even really know anything about it.
Well, Oktoberfest sort of began as a wedding celebration. Oh. Like, 150 years ago or something like that. And it just kind of went from there. It was like this super long, like a week and a half long party for this duke or whatever that got married. And the tradition just kept going and kept going and kept going and became what it is today. Now it's a worldwide, like, month-long celebration.
That's a worldwide bender for 10% of the year.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just awesome.
You never know what you're going to learn on Ritual Misery. Thank you.
Now, as I was saying earlier, this is our part of our big count up to 100, to episode 100, beta 100. And Bonnie so graciously came on the show for episode beta 95. Beta 96, hopefully, will be a Diamond Club meetup on the air. Like, we're actually going to have it. It's going to be open lines. We're going to have as many people on as possible. Spin whatever you want to spin. Tell a joke. Critique the show. That should be fun.
We're probably going to set up some games. Come on and play one of our games.
Yeah.
Just whatever. It's going to be
Or we could bail out of the whole thing. We don't know. So come on by.
Probably not the second one. Probably not the second one.
But he said probably not definitely. So that'll be in 2 weeks, 2 weeks from tonight. And I think the show after that, it's not confirmed. I'm just going to tell you right now, it's not confirmed. But I think we're going to have Stacy on for 97, right?
I think so.
That's the plan?
Yep.
So
Stacy Baldwin.
She's awesome. She was there at South by. She's amazing. She's funny, and she's involved in every podcast under the sun right now. It's crazy. She decided, you know what, I'm gonna try this podcast thing, and boom, yeah. She's everywhere. Like, she's just all over the place. So
exactly.
I believe
we
she'll
need
be
to get on,
that.
We need to get on that bus. We need to
right.
Get
like
on our show.
We just had this. We just been sitting here doing this for 2 years. Like, we haven't expanded at all.
Right.
And then see 98, we got a soft confirmation from our guest on 98. 99, we've got a soft confirmation from 99. And then episode 100, we're still hoping and praying they answer the emails. So more on that as we get closer. It's going to be amazing. Regardless, it's going to be amazing.
Yep, absolutely.
So
now, well, you guys sound like you're going to have a heck of a good time here. That's awesome.
Yeah, things like bringing you on the show, we wanted to. We've always wanted to, but we never had the cojones to actually ask.
I'm just so flattered.
And then it came in, and it was like, you know what? This is the chance. Like, why not? Why not now? Why not? Like,
exactly.
Why not? And, you know, it came across like, yes. We were actually Skyping on some off-show stuff when your response came back, and Kent was like, hey, dude, here you go.
She like, said so, yes. She said yes.
No, you guys are awesome. I really enjoyed meeting you guys. You know, at the different. I don't know. It's totally easy to be around you. So of course I'll be on your podcast.
Thank you. Bye. That being said, Bonnie.
Yes.
Like, so we got a couple things left. Just a couple things.
We should
be done in just a few minutes. Like, you know, maybe 30 seconds or so. Doubt it.
Okay.
First thing, where can people find more about you, what you have going on, and let you know how awesome you were on the show tonight?
Let's see. You can find me on just Invisible Wife on Twitter. And that's probably the best way. Like, if I have any news, I'll put it out there. I've got a lot of projects going on, but I'm not ready to shout out about it just yet.
Kind of like our future guests.
Yeah. Awesome.
Also, you know, just catch us on Night Attack. And, all you know, we got the Night Attack album coming up pretty soon.
Yeah.
So that hopefully will be out before Christmas. I think that'd be awesome.
Some final details on that just this week, right?
Right, right. They're talking some more. Although I think they need to record a little bit, and Brian got really sick, so they couldn't do it this weekend. Well. I'll have to do it later.
Is there okay, I have a quick question. Is there ever going to be a solo MC Allergy album?
We hadn't brought that up the entire show.
What's that?
We hadn't brought up MC Allergy the entire show. We talked all around it.
We think of that as an actual thing. That's just kind of spoof. So, but there is, like, I think Bryce has all these tracks, and I feel sorry for him because, like, who wants to listen? He's like a musician, so he shouldn't have to listen to my voice, but... I think there's some kind of album that got put together at some point, and it's just, I don't know. It's one of those projects that just got fizzled, and but the tracks took light somewhere else, so I don't know.
Speaking of Bryce real quick, he's got some great stuff on SoundCloud.
Oh, yeah. No, I enjoy his music. It's worth, you know, you have your friends that make stuff, and then it's always a pleasure, like, when you actually like what they do. And I felt like that. I was really worried about reading Andrew Main's books because I thought, oh, come on. Like, you writing. I love his books. They are so good. And I also feel the same way about Neshcom's music. It's worth checking out. So
yeah. Look, SoundCloud, look up Nesh Complex.
Neshcom. Yeah. He's got some good music.
Yeah.
Yep. Definitely. I'm a patron of his on there, actually.
Oh, are you? That's great.
Speaking of patrons, Kent.
Yeah.
Now, we got some more details coming on this a little bit later. But we've had a few patrons kick in here lately, just added, like, almost doubled our patron count here lately, which isn't saying too much, but is so amazingly appreciated for us. And that secret Diamond Club project that I kept talking about and kept talking about. If you're a patron of the Ritual Misery podcast, you've got the raw, uncut recording of that project, episode one, in the patron-only feed, ready for your to salt your ears. And it's amazing. It's great. I'm like, my part sucks. Whatever. But the other half of that is amazing.
It was fantastic. And do you want to say what it is?
No.
I mean, okay.
No, we'll say what it is when it's actually released.
It is absolutely fantastic. It involves another listeners to this show.
A prominent diamond clubber.
Will recognize the other person involved.
Yeah, a prominent diamond clubber.
Yeah, and it's just fantastic. I listened to it. It's about what is it? An hour and something. Like, I think
an hour five.
Hmm. Yeah, and it's, dude, I couldn't turn it off. It was just. It was really good. Really good stuff.
So there's your tease. If you'd like to get your hands on that, it's going to cost you $1 every 100 months. So you do the math on that, and that's all it is. We really appreciate all the patrons that are out there that are helping us out. And as much or as little as you want, there's a certain way to game the system. If you want to let me know about that, let me know, and I can help you out with that. But it's great, and we really appreciate it. It's making this show something that we can... let's just be honest. Something I can tell my wife is worth it.
I know what you're talking about.
It's the SO factor, the significant other factor.
Right.
But yeah, it's awesome, and we really appreciate it. We are counting down to 100. We promise really great things to come, like this show right here. Awesome, amazing guests coming in. Bonnie's just she's mid stride on a huge run of awesome guests, and hopefully afterwards we'll be able to keep it going. But we're kicking ass, and this show's just getting better, and especially with people like Bonnie helping us out and telling us to stop the ums and uhs.
Exactly.
Well, I don't have any criticism now. You guys are doing great. This is amazing.
Well, I appreciate that. Amos, where are you at on the internet?
At Ethan Kane. Like, because that makes sense. My name's Anthony. I go by Amos, and my Twitter handle's Ethan Kane. Like, duh.
Yeah, that totally makes sense.
Meanwhile, my wife's name is Cerethia. She goes by Cerethia, and her Twitter handle is Cerethia. So, like, I lost that game.
That's just confusing. I don't understand that.
Yeah, that makes no sense.
Meanwhile, you can find me on Twitter at @rm_delnoche.
And if you like beer.
I was late to the game. I was late to the game, so I got the underscore in my name. I did not even mean for that to rhyme, but that was kind of cool. But if you're a beer guy like me, you can go to ratebeer.com and read my beer reviews. Just look up username Del Noche. You can find the show on Twitter at Ritual Misery.
Kent, there's something we forgot to do something.
We didn't forget.
We didn't forget? Calling me out like that?
I didn't forget. Did you forget?
Well, no. No, I didn't forget.
Okay, so throughout the show, we've been doing a bit called Ritual Liberty. Basically what that is, we've been secretly selecting words that have been spoken throughout the show. It could have been by Bonnie, it could have been by me, it could have been by Amos. We've been gathering, harvesting these words that were spoken and compiling them. It could be an answer to a question, it could have just been a random word that caught our attention. And we have plugged those words into a Mad Lib style story.
It's not even style. It's straight Mad Libs. Like, I got a bunch of these damn Mad Libs that we're probably doing copyright infringement on. I don't care.
Probably.
Because y'all need to buy some of these sons of bitches, right? These things are amazing. You can get them for, like I said, like, it's a dollar. What is it? A dollar. You can get these things for a dollar. They're amazing.
So, Amos, you want to read Bonnie's story?
Oh, it's personalized.
This one is entitled.
Well, this is... We select the stories just kind of based on, like, who the guest is, like whether it's a personality trait or an interest or something like that. And I don't know. It's kind of a new thing that we're trying. This is what, the third or fourth time that we've done this, Amos?
Sure. Sounds good.
Yeah. So anyway,
the first one was completely off the cuff and amazing with Richard Gunther. And since then, we've been using these Mad Libs that I just happen to have sitting around.
Oh, that's fantastic. So I love games like this.
So here we are you ready? This one is entitled Just Like Mom.
Okay.
When I grow up, I want to be a space pirate, just like my mom. She's worked really hard to get there, and mom said it's worth every charming minute. It all started when she was 12 years old. She went to see the movie Itchy Buttworms, and that was enough. All mom could think about was being a space pirate. Mom went to school for 3 years in Kentucky to make sure she had the right training. Then she decided to move to Texas, where she could open her business. And during all of this, she met and Peter Pan's in front of my dad and started a family. I know that it's going to be anaphylactic, but just think how proud she's going to be when I tell her that I want to be a space pirate, all because of her.
Oh, that is really fun. That's a good one. I like it.
I honestly didn't see about 2/3 of the words that Kent selected and threw into the little spreadsheet. So I was kind of just watching it grow as it went along. And that was awesome. That was great.
Oh, man. So much fun, Bonnie. Thank you again so very much for coming on the show. We really hope to have you again. This has been awesome.
Anytime. This has been great, and I really enjoy that you guys are putting out some good content. So very cool.
Thank you.
Yay.
I'm Amos. That's Del Noche, and that's Invisible Wife.
Hi.
You can submit ideas for this show right here, ritualmisery.reddit.com, because everybody's got a Reddit, and that's just how things go. Everybody's got a Reddit. You can email us podcast@ritualmisery.com. You can call and leave us a voicemail, 567-69-TRMPC. That's 567-698-7672. And of course, you can find all these ways and more ways to support the show on our website, ritualmisery.com. Thank you so much to Kevin McLeod for allowing us to use your music, which I started late because I'm a doofus. Thank you for listening, for Kent, for Bonnie, for me, and for you. This is your Ritual Misery Podcast.
See ya.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Excellent.
Awesome. Welcome to the post show.